Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the Compassionate, the Most Merciful, to all of our viewers out there, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. And welcome back to the rationale, the intersection of faith and reason with our guest here, Dr. Jaafar, Sheikh Idris. Dr. Jaafar, once again, thank you for being with us here today. Last time, we were talking about Islam's view of the others. And you said that the other is always non-Muslim, regardless of which particular faith group that they belong to. And we spoke about this misconception that people have about Islam, that Islam is here to spread by the sword or was spread by the sword, and Muslims are either here to eliminate or convert people. And you mentioned an interesting article where an Israeli was who happened to be an atheist, he was talking about how good Muslims were to their fellow Jewish brethren that they came and they resided there. And I remember a statement that was made about the golden era of both Judaism and Islam in Spain, to the extent that Moses Maimonides, Musa ibn Mahran, we would call him in Arabic, was a great Jewish philosopher. He wrote his most famous book, Decoding Torah, and he wrote it in Arabic. And he was an Orthodox Jew, and usually they would write this in the holy tongue of Hebrew. But he chose to write it in Arabic because he felt that it was going to be the Muslims who would actually preserve that work of his. And you said that history gives this great testimony of how Islam was tolerant to the other.
Yes.
And you also make another comment, and you say that it was actually during peaceful times that Islam spread.
Yes, because this is an added reason why we should tolerate people who choose to live with us in peace. You know, we will welcome them. Why? Because the experience of Muslims is that in times of peace, Islam spreads better than in times of war. This was the first experience that many of the early scholars talked about, was the experience of the peace treaty that the Prophet had with the people of Mecca, called Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. They said during those 2 years of peace, more people became Muslims than the number of people who became Muslims before that, even from the beginning of the invitation, the beginning of the prophethood of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And some companions of the Prophet explained this by saying that before that peace, it was only fighting, it was only the hatred and so on. But in those 2 years of peace, people began, especially from Mecca, the non-Muslims began to come to visit Medina and meet the Muslims. And this companion of the Prophet said that no rational person who heard the message from the Muslims refused to accept it. No rational person. That is why many people accepted the message. Now, as you, I think you said in one of this episode, that this is what now is happening in the West, because there is peace now. Muslims are living in peace with non-Muslims. Islam is spreading. Islam is spreading because of this peace. And in spite of the fact that Muslims countries are weak, there is nothing inviting for a person to accept Islam, except the truth that he finds in the book. So when there is peace, Islam spreads rather when there is war. So Our choice as Muslims should always be peace. But if we have to fight, then we have to fight. We will not say we will not fight under any circumstances.
But peace would be the fertile land
yes.
that Muslims would look for.
وإن جنحوا للسلم فجنح لها وتوكل على الله.
Sheikh, you can also see places like India, where Muslims have been in it for over 800 years, yet the majority of Indians are actually not Muslims, an indication that there is no compulsion in religion and had the desire of Muslims being just to convert people. India is the testimony that the majority of the people are still not Muslims at this time.
And this is encouraging Muslims now to be active in inviting people, like this channel now. This channel now is mainly geared or directed towards people who are not Muslims. And when we speak, we have no power to compel people. We are not just talking to them. And it seems to me there are now reasons why Islam is spreading so fast in the world. I think one of the reasons, and you know this better than I do, that many religious people in the West are beginning to have doubts about the authenticity of their scriptures and so on. So when they compare this with the Quran, as we said before, and they find that there is historical reasons for the authenticity of the Quran, some of them, this will be a reason why they would accept Islam. Also, you know that faith in secularism is waning. At first, many people thought that secularism will take the place of religion and it will solve all problems and there will be no wars, the religious wars and so on. All people will be secular, they will be democratic and so on. But this is no longer the case. And I think also a very important reason and I see many Muslims now exploiting that. Very important reason is that the best thing that the West has is science. And it is because of science and the technology that is based on it that that the West is so much advanced as far as material progress is concerned. Now, this science is based on reason. And therefore, it becomes very difficult for a person who believes in science to accept a religion which in which there is contradiction between it and science. And perhaps people will discover that the only religion, if we talk about this perhaps in one of our episodes about the relationship between science and religion. People will have, and already in fact I know of some people who became Muslims because of this. So this is one of also the good reasons why people are coming to the fold of Islam.
Sheikh, you know, that a question just presents itself. Do you feel that the Muslims are we doing our duties towards our non-Muslim brethren out there?
I think many of us are doing. Many of us, and as I have just said, this channel is a good example. Yeah? We are now explaining to them what this religion means. And this, in this way, we are doing them a big service.
Sure.
If they,
because like you said, living in the West, you get the sense that people are not necessarily happy with their own faith teachings where they are, and they're looking for alternatives, and people are willing to try anything and everything out there because you do feel that, you know, they truly want a relationship with their creator, and many are considering Islam at this point.
I see.
Okay. Sheikh, what about the fact that I know you said earlier that you did not necessarily want to go into details about this. But then again, you know, amongst the others are the people of the book. And you said earlier that Islam has the ability of, because of these different bridges that we have with people. Any special thing that is said about specifically the people of the book?
I think you know this, because, for example, you are allowed to marry, Muslim men are allowed to marry, take spouses from of the Jewish or Christian religion. This is especially for them. Mm-hmm. And Islam, why? This also shows you that this religion is a very fair religion, because we know that many of the beliefs of the Christians and Jews are true. They are not like people who deny the existence of the Creator, not like people who deny that God sent any prophet, not like people who say there is no life after death. And most perhaps important is that they believe in moral values. And so there is much that is common between us. And it is a pity that now some Christian leaders are waging a war against Islam as if it is the most distant ideology or religion from the Christian faith. This is not true. We are nearer to them than other religions and other, especially secular beliefs.
Yeah, and I like what you said in one of the previous episodes that we had, that because of Islam, yes, a billion people have more respect to Jesus, peace be upon him. Yes, yeah. And that is indeed beautiful. Mm-hmm. Dr. Jaafar, we will going to take a short break, inshallah, and we will come back and continue our talk about the others and the spread of Islam. Please stay tuned, and we shall return shortly, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back again to The Rationale, the intersection of faith and reason, with our guest here, Dr. Jaafar Sheikh Idris. Dr. Jaafar, we were talking about Islam's view of the other, specifically about the Jews and Christians, or Ahl al-Kitab, people of the scripture, of the book, as the Quran calls them, and you spoke about how closer we are to them, and I believe you gave four different reasons, the belief in the oneness of God, divine moral values.
The oneness of the Creator.
Oneness of the Creator, divine moral guidelines. Mm. You speak about the fact that they do believe in previous messengers that were sent to them, and also the belief in the hereafter, and that makes them closer to us than some other beliefs. Yeah. You also make a point that Islam makes a distinction between beliefs and believers.
Yes, I thought of this while I was in the United States, and it was because of something that one of the American presidents said. He argued from the fact that Muslims believe that he was an earlier president, not this president.
Okay. I think I know which one you're talking about, okay. But we'll leave it unsaid.
Okay. He argued from the fact that Muslims believe what he called, that he said that Muslims believe that they have the whole truth. And therefore, he jumped to the conclusion, that is why they believe that no one else, the life of everyone else is not worth anything. He's not worthy to live.
I'm not sure. How do you make that?
Oh, okay. Yes, I will.
Conclusion.
I don't know, because this is the whole truth. Then, if you don't believe in the whole truth, you are not worthy of being alive, and therefore, he thought that this is the justification for them to kill anyone who is not one of them. So I said that, as you have just now noticed, that there is a logical gap here. You can't argue from this to this. It is true that in Islam there is a distinction between your position regarding beliefs and your position regarding the believers of those false beliefs. Mm-hmm. As far as beliefs are concerned, there is no compromise. No compromise at all. Mm-hmm. This is the truth which is revealed to us from God, and everything that contradicts it is false. Mm-hmm. We must say this clearly and courageously without any hesitation. Mm-hmm. Everything that contradicts, just as this is the position of scientists. Sure. If a scientist has the proof that the earth is spherical, he will not
tolerate
say,
any.
He will not tolerate other ideas. But that doesn't mean that he will not tolerate the people who believe that the earth is flat. He will not go and kill them. The same thing with Islam. We say your beliefs are false, but we are ready to argue with you to prove to you that these beliefs are false. We are ready to argue with you according to what we mentioned before, rationally and on the basis of moral values. And we are ready to answer any questions that you have. And we will not compel you to accept this truth. And we will invite you in the best of ways, because this is what our religion tells us to do. But there is this distinction between the two. Now, suppose that someone said, as this president said, it seems that he said, or that he thought, that you become tolerant only if you don't believe that you have the absolute truth. Hmm. And he said that truth or life is a journey, that we are always acquiring more knowledge and so on and so on. But as you have just said, I think that there is a logical gap here. Why? What is it that prevents me from not killing those who don't agree with me? Yeah? I can say to myself, yes, I have the absolute truth. But my duty towards those who don't have the absolute truth is to invite them to
this truth.
God, as I said in commenting on this statement when it was made, I said, God sends prophets with books. He doesn't send generals with machine guns to kill everyone that disagrees. And also, it doesn't mean that the person who doesn't believe that he has the whole truth, or who believes that truth is relative, will be tolerant towards others, because he might also say, truth is relative. This person is claiming that he has the whole truth, so why tolerate him? So it doesn't follow this way or that way.
In other words, Sheikh, if I am hearing you correctly, you're saying that tolerance is for the individuals, but not to the points that they're making.
Not for
the point remains. If we believe that the point is false, it remains false.
It remains false.
However, tolerance is towards the individual who.
And why do we tolerate the individuals? Because we do see this mostly in the hope that they will see the truth and come to the to accept it. And this is what is happening now. Some people start as being enemies of Islam, and they, for example, some people used to hate the Prophet. Then they became among the most pious people and the people who loved the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Because they were invited and they were shown that.
And they were given the chance to live, to live with Muslims, and to given the chance to see the truth.
Yes. That story that you mentioned, Sheikh, you reminded me of a book now that I regret not buying it. And the title of the book was very captivating. It said that the title was Crimes Against Logic. And I thought that the title itself was just worth buying the book, because of these logical gaps that people make here and there. Yeah. Sheikh, I think a question that also poses itself, and that is, what do we do about some of the practices of the Muslims that are out there that actually promote this view that some of the non-Muslims have about Islam and Muslims?
Again, we tell these people that you have to be realistic. You don't imagine that this billion individuals will be strict in practicing their religion, and will be just reflections of living examples of what is in the book. So we are not inviting you to the practice of the Muslims. We are inviting you to the beliefs of these Muslims as they are stated in the Quran. And we don't expect you, even you, when you become, if you accept this truth, we don't expect you to be a model like the Prophet or like the big saints. It is enough for you to accept that the basic fundamentals of the religion and do your best to be a good person. So don't turn away from the truth because some people who claim that they have that truth are not acting in accordance with that claim. And I think this is something also a rational person will do.
Not to make that link between what people claim to believe and then...
Not all the time, yes, but generally, of course, we can't say that the Islamic religion has nothing to do with the practice of Muslims. I mean, I heard some Muslims say this. But someone might say that if it doesn't have any effect on the Muslims, then it will not have any effect on me. So why become a Muslim? Mm-hmm. Of course, there are good effects of the religion on Muslims. But we are saying that they are not like the Prophet ﷺ, and don't think of them in this idealistic. They are human beings, they make mistakes, but many of them are very good people if you come to know them. And generally speaking, I think Muslims generally, as far as moral values and abstaining from certain grave crimes like killing, for example, and fornication, adultery, and so on. And this was mentioned by one Catholic professor of philosophy. He was explaining why Islam is the fastest growing religion, and he mentioned this. He said, compare us with them. These are the people who pray to God more than anyone does. Practicing Muslims, there are less crimes of fornication, of adultery, and so on among Muslims than among other people. So Islam does have, and perhaps he forgot also to mention something that we can see very clear: our relationship with our relatives, still Muslims. Mm-hmm. Even those who are not very good at practicing religion, at least they practice this part of the religion. They love their relatives, even some of the remote ones, and they help them. So there is real good relationship among Muslims than generally than there is among other among non-Muslims.
And Sheikh, I think you alluded to this also earlier when you said that as Muslims, we are encouraged to make that personal approach to the way we invite people to Islam, marrying, you know, from amongst them,
yes,
the food that we eat. And it gives us an opportunity to have that social interaction through which people are able to get to know us. Sheikh Jaafar, I think that your message was loud and clear. Our job is to invite people, not to compel them. Our job is to convey the message and not to convert people, to bring about understanding between us and the others and not necessarily to make Muslims.
Of course, when we convey the message, we want them to be converted, sure. But we cannot, don't have the power to convert them.
Because yes, faith resides in the heart. Yeah. Sheikh Jaafar, again, that was a beautiful, beautiful time that we have spent with you. And also, I would, on behalf of the viewers out there, we would really, really thank you and appreciate the fact that you are spending this time with us. Jazakallah khair. And with this, we come to the conclusion of this part of our program. Until we see you, and we hope that you would join us next time as well. Till then, we say so long, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.